So hello, I'm Thomas Patzke. I'm one of the two main contributors of Sigma, with, together with Florian Roth. And today I will tell you a bit about the updates we had in Sigma since the last attack community meeting in Brussels. So, first of all, how is Sigma related to MITRE ATT&CK? So, 80% of the Sigma rules in the main Sigma repository that we open source are tagged with MITRE ATT&CK tags, so are related to some techniques or so. So, this improved very well, and it's quite common now for users that when they write a Sigma rule, that they also include directly the ATT&CK tagging. So even in my workshop this year at HackLoo, I've seen this, that the participants directly put some ATT&CK tags in it. And that's really great. Last year, it was different, but the people already see this as a part of a Sigma rule. And I think that's very cool. And that's also used, for example, by the ATC project to link Sigma rules to other elements like playbooks or course of action items, and it's a great advantage that arises from this tagging. Okay, so what's new in Sigma and what are our plans? I start with the value modifiers. So what was the motivation? So many Sigma rules contain base64 encoded blobs, and you weren't able to see what this is. Some things were not so easy to express, and sometimes default behaviors were not appropriate, like values or lists are handled in Sigma. And this was for the reason why we introduced the value modifiers, which allow to do some encoding of values or treat values as something different, so not as plain value, but as a regular expression, for instance. And the syntax is quite simple. So after the field name in a Sigma rule, you can add the modifiers separated by a pipe, and you can also chain modifiers. So what we have currently, one is the contains modifier. So usually a list, or normally a list is or linked. This is usually what you want in detection of lock events with a it's a all operator or all modifier. You are able to change this behavior to an AND linking, so that you can list down the properties or the values that should be contained in one lock event field. Yes, and then we added further modifiers like base64, so you can let the Sigma converter do the encoding for you, and you have the plain rules in the plain values in the Sigma rule, so that the readability is better. Or you can you have the base64 offset converter value modifier that puts calculates three different base64 encodings. So when there's a padding before the value, you can now convert values into different encodings, mainly UTF-16, because this is what you usually have in, for example, in PowerShell with encoded payloads. And yes, Sigma now also supports regular expressions. You can tell the Sigma converter that the value is not a plain value, but a regular expression. And then it is passed to the conversion backend that makes the final query. Currently, it is supported by, I think it's definitely the Elasticsearch backend, because I have implemented this, and I think it was a Curator backend that now also is capable of this. And yes, hopefully further will be contributed, because we only have access to few backend types. So how this looks like practically, you see this in the button after the selection. So the third line from the button, the command line, is first converted into a white value. This means, I can show to this. This means UTF-16 lower endian encoding than the base 64 offset value modifier is applied. The value is then converted into three different values with different offsets before the plane write encoded value, and contains puts wildcards around the final value so that it is matched anywhere in the command line. Okay, how the generated query looks like. We see a command line and the three values would be matched here. Yes, the result, an event is identified that contains this value. And when we decode this, we see it's indeed UTF-16 encoded with the null characters in between each character. And yes, it works fine, and it makes Sigma rules more readable where such techniques are used. And it's quite easy to implement new modifiers. So when you have ideas, feel free to open an issue or feel free to make a pull request. I wrote also a blog article about it at patzke.org, where my blog is, where I sometimes write something about Sigma. And usually it's only a few lines of code to write write a new modifier. next new thing, the Sigma converter configuration. Yes, first, what was the issue? What was wrong with Sigma configurations? So Sigma configurations are basically the piece of text file, YAML-based, where you configure the mapping to your target behavior. So when you have a different field naming, you have indexes where you store your data, you have a specific structure in your ZM system, and this is specific to your environment, and you can configure this in the configurations. What was wrong with the system? So it was not very user-friendly, because usually conversion requires a configuration, and before I've made the changes, when you converted something without a configuration, you just got some kind of query. You put this query into your CM and nothing matched. Maybe you say, thought about it that everything is fine, but in fact, it wasn't able to match because field naming used in the query was not specific to your environment. And it was also hard to determine which config is appropriate for your setup, because it were plain text files without any description. Just the file name gives you a hint for which purpose it could be used, for which backend system. And so it was also not so user-friendly. Users had to enter full pass to the configuration. So when you installed Sigma with pip or pipx, it was contained somewhere in your file system, and you have first to find out where these files are located. It was possible to use stacked configurations, so you can use multiple configuration which builds one on each other, and the order of this configuration matters. But you was able to use the configuration in the wrong order. And yes, finally, configuration, for example, for Splunk could also be used with the Elasticsearch backend. So you was able to completely mess up the usage with the Sigma converter, and the Sigma converter just gave you a result, but this result was wrong, and it was not working in your environment. In the best case, your CM system would maybe say, okay, there's something wrong. Usually, it simply doesn't work. So, the improvements. Now the Sigma converter refuses to convert rules if the backend doesn't matches to the configuration, or if the order is wrong, or if you should provide a configuration, but you didn't have done this. So you get an error. I will show a screenshot in the next slide. And the converter directly tells you which are the configurations that could be useful for you, that you possibly be supposed to use. Now you can also output a list of all available configurations. So there is a bunch of configurations already contained in the Sigma project. Every configuration has now a title and a bit of description that you get more an idea about it for which purpose it's could be usable for you. And now you can specify a configuration only with the file name without any path around it and without the suffix, because there's now an auto-discovery tool, and Sigma now, the converter now searches for the configurations in the installation path and so on, and so you don't have to search for these configurations on your own. And yes, finally, the order of configurations is checked too, so you can't use them in the wrong order anymore. If you want to use them in the wrong order, there is an undocumented parameter named "should yourself in the food," but obviously you shouldn't use it. So how this looks like, this is a list of configurations, or part of the list of configurations. There are more contained in the open source repository. You see, you don't have to give the full name, but only here Splunk Windows, but it doesn't match in this example to the backend, to Elasticsearch, and you get error and no result. And or if you don't use a configuration, but the Elasticsearch query string backend has to be used with a config, then you get a list of configurations that are possible in the setup and with this backend. Okay, bug fixes and improvements. We have added, and contributors have added, Elastic Stack 7.x support. So there's new field naming and some further stuff that will be likely changed in the future. And we already prepared the Elasticsearch backend on configuration for this. Yes, many improvements and fixes. We have some new backends. In the background, and yes, I implemented some new features, but what's currently the focus also lies on refactoring, making the code better readable, because I also want to document this. This is something what people who want to contribute sometimes complain about, that the documentation is not sufficient for this, and they are right. And yes, so a lot of work ahead. So code cleanup, it's not very sexy, but it's necessary to make it more usable for contributors. Okay, another issue. Oh, a bit messed up. Rule licensing. Currently, the open source repository rules are licensed with GPL. GPL is problematic regarding this, because the question is, is the generated query from a GPL rule also GPL? This could mean that when you take the query and baseline it specific to your environment, when you follow the license, you have to contribute your baselining back to the repository, which would make absolutely sense, because it's specific to your environment, so we don't care about it in our repository, and you don't want to expose your infrastructure in a public repository. So this is one problem. Must the baselining be contributed back? Florian opened an issue regarding this. So it's a big thing, because we have to ask every contributor of rules if it's okay to change the licensing of the rules. And from this issue, discussion arose about the best license for this purpose. So our first idea was Creative Commons by SA, but some people proposed other licenses. MIT was few weeks of favorite, but what is important for us and for the contributors is the attribution aspect. And MIT license only says shall about contribution, so it's not a must. So yes, back to the start. And yes, maybe it would be Creative Commons by SA, but it's, I think it also has a bit of this GPA problem, and we have find the final license. Anyways, yesterday I added this to the specification, so a license attribute in the Sigma rule, so that we are able to keep Sigma rules with different licenses in the same repository. For example, when people say they don't want to move away from GPL, we can still keep it in the repository. And yes, it makes things a bit more complicated, but I think that's how open source works when you have many contributors for such small pieces of rules in such a big rule set. Yes, further plans. As announced in the last tech community meeting, I said stable releases. We are still working on it, so there's a lot of stuff to do in the background, which you don't see as new features or so, but is required that we can say, okay, now we have a 1.0 release, and from this on we keep it more structured a bit. Improving coverage of Sigma rule set, OSCD, I have a dedicated slide to this. Improvement of the documentation, as I told before, tool to convert exactly the attack mapping from the existing Sigma rules, so that are over 280 rules, I think, that have attack mapping, and we also want to go to the new attack mapping with the sub-techniques and so on. And so I think the best way here would be to write a tool for this purpose that automates the process and maybe tells where some manual intervention is required. Yes. One project I also talked with the MISP guys about, this is MISP to Sigma, so build something. Okay, it's the other direction. It's build. No, it's the right direction. So Sigma to MISP we already have, and MISP to Sigma is we are thinking how we can build Sigma rules from MISP events, and there's also the idea to and this is other direction to build up a MISP instance where all rules from the Sigma repository are contained and synced from this. So it's also a bit of work, and I think we have to discuss the further details. We already had some very fruitful discussions about this, and we'll continue on this. And one thing that is very important, because we have a lot of Sigma rules, so over 330 rules, and now over 17 will be added by the OSCD community effort. So a lot of issue, and how we ensure the quality of the Sigma rules. And the idea is to build a detection testing framework, likely outside of Sigma, so a dedicated project that is more generic and that can also be used to test the quality of detections for other projects. Okay. Yes, the driving home from Hackloo project. So every time I drive home from Hackloo, I write some small piece of code that do something. This time it will likely be this, the last time it was Sigma to MISP. This time it would be the Sigma rule distance calculator. So a tool that tries to give two Sigma rules a score, depending on how similar they are. So, let's look how far I get with this. Okay. And yes, Open Security Collaborative Development, so OSCD. This week we made a sprint here in this community effort. So there is a website and a Slack that describes it. Thanks to the Hacklu organizers, they gave us a room yesterday where we could sit down and work together on this. And currently we have 74 new rules. This is really a lot of new stuff for the repository, and in the next, I think, weeks, we will then integrate them into the master branch of the Sigma project. So everyone who participated this, thanks a lot for this. And that was
Thank you.